again, we're going to go ahead and I'll introduce you to Rodney S. Jones. He is the president and CEO of Adjustment Bureau Consulting. Rodney S. Jones is a captivating and engaging coach, consultant, speaker, and trainer. He believes emerging executives with the right knowledge, skill sets, and coaching. Rodney's path is unquestionably one that is less traveled. While attending the University of Texas, he voluntarily assumed full legal custody of his two younger sisters. And I see the gang sign, so watch what you guys do. I just saw that. I used to work in a prison. I see everything going on. As a result, he was thrust into the business world in what most would say was a premature manner. It was during this time that he learned the importance of soft skills that are needed to compete on the business level. After spending over a decade in the financial industry, years in management, and extensive time with a leading professional recruiting firm, Rodney has become an expert in changing the culture of professional environments by focusing on the one common denominator. And I think it's the one thing that many people forget, people. So please join me in welcoming Rodney S. Jones.
All right. Well, thank you, Cutting Jones. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. So what she didn't mention was, you know, the eating and running part. I'm concerned about the eating and sleeping part. Okay? So I talk loud and I'm mic'd up. And so if I come down and get beside you, you know, and say, you know, so what I mean to say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. But what I want to do is, you know, first of all, just commend all of the presenters, keynote speaker that we had today. I think they deserve another round of applause because they're giving this up. They're doing this so that you all can have necessary resources and tools that you need to go to the next level, and that's what we all want to do. I was taking notes, so no one's above, you know, above taking notes or above learning. What I want to do is, I learned when I was sitting in this morning session that when you get a group of professionals who are well-versed in the same space, you're going to quickly find out that there's nothing new under the sun, right? What that should do is give you an assurance that it's kind of like, you know, if someone says your breath stinks, and then 2 minutes later a different person says your breath stinks, your breath probably stinks, right? So that means that there's a truth to what's going on. There's a truth to what's being said. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put my own personal spin on this same truth. And it's a spin that's wrapped around my own, you know, personal experiences as well as professional experiences. I'm going to give you a lot of information in a condensed period of time. So get it while you can, and there'll be, you know, there's other sessions. Like I said, you'll be able to get it from others. I'm doing another session after this. But I want to start with letting you know a little bit about, you know, me, my background, where I come from, so that I can validate why I can stand up here and share with you what I have. As was mentioned, I went to the University of Texas in Austin. Hook 'em horns, we won our first tournament game. Probably gonna get bounced by Michigan, but whatever. So I went to the University of Texas, and something happened in my life that changed me for the rest of my life. May 5th, 1998, I made a voluntary decision to take full legal custody of my two younger sisters. Now, at the time that I did it, it was just as simple as blinking. It was something that didn't need a lot of thinking. I didn't have to pray and fast and consult people or anything like that. There were things going on. I needed to step in, you know, make the decision, make the call. But what I didn't know is that that decision would then form the rest of my life in a different way. I was 22. They were 12 and 15. I told a Texas judge when she asked, "What makes you think you can take care of them?" I said these words, "I can at least give them a meal." Little did I know that girls need more than a meal. I'm just saying, right? Boys, haircut and some shoes, we good. No. So what happened was that thrust me into the business world, again, what most would say is prematurely. And what I mean by that is I was a teller making $8.80 an hour, working part-time, full-time, because I had to pay my half of the rent, and going to school. Overnight now, I'm a parent with two other mouths to feed, so I needed what I call a big boy check. I needed that money that people get when they graduate because I'm running short. And student loans, I can't keep digging myself in debt. So I had to go into the workforce, but I realized I was going with a disadvantage, so to speak. No degree, no experience, no connections, and competing with people who had that and then some. Nonetheless, I had to make it happen because I got two mouths that say, you said you was going to take care of us, right? So at that time, I started going through this trial and error type phase, trying to learn what works. I know what I don't have, but how can I magnify what I do have in order to get what I need? And that's when I found this thing, the genesis of this thing I now call corporate swagger. The reason I call it corporate swagger is because it's just a mindset. It's a mindset, and I'm a sports fan. Just moved here from Houston. Y'all are Georgia Bulldog fanatics. I mean, I don't get it. Georgia State is like in the city, but they get no respect, but whatever. So in a sense of using sports, corporate swagger is just a mindset that says, okay, when I step on the court, field, whatever, boardroom, interview room, conference room, whatever that stage is, when I step on it, it's game over. I won, and we haven't even started yet. That's the mindset. That was the only thing that saved me. Now, it was good to go in with that mindset, but I didn't have much resources because when I went to my career services center at University of Texas, you know, they didn't sit me down and say, oh, you're going to need this. You're going to need this. Oh, these subtle nuances, you're going to make sure that you're well-versed in those. This is what they're looking for. I had to learn that trial and error. So through trial and error, I got good at it. So good to whereas I was able to snatch jobs from people who did have degrees in prominent areas. Now, I'm not saying that to brag. What I'm saying is if I could do it without a degree, if someone were to give me that knowledge and then I have a degree, I have experience in a trade, it's lights out, game over, and we haven't even started. So does anybody want some corporate swagger? I'm going to give it to you regardless because that's what they want me to do. So I had, you know, careers in finance. I still carry professional financial licenses. Had a career in recruiting where I learned what was needed on the opposite side of the table. A lot of the things that Mr. Yate was speaking of this morning, so true. I mean, so true. As a recruiter, see, you have to understand it from their standpoint. Recruiting is such a volatile industry. The turnaround in it is just rapid fire, right? If you can last 5 months in the recruiting industry, that's the equivalent of 5 years because it's so fluid. And it depends on factors like the economy, right? Factors that we can't control, like candidates, like job, hiring executives. So in the mind of a recruiter, I'm just gonna be honest, a recruiter's trying to get paid. That's why they only spend 6 seconds on a resume. I did it. They give us access to Monster and Career Builder. They say, go get the resumes. You need to interview 10 candidates a week. In addition to that, I need to go out and talk with potential hiring managers and find out what do they want. So I'm playing this matchmaker game as a recruiter. I'm going and talking to CFOs, CEOs, HR executives to find out what's a good fit for you. What's your environment like? I get all that information. I come back to the office. I'm scouring for resumes. 6 seconds, 6 seconds. Nope, 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 maybe, nope, 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 maybe. Some of those nopes may be your nopes. It's just that real because as a recruiter, it's about quick money. That's what they're trying to do. Let me preface all this. I'm going to talk to y'all like y'all were family. So you're not going to get a bunch of college rhetoric. I know those words, but I'm going to give it to you where you need it. Is that fair enough? Okay. So they're trying to get paid. So in this field, you know, I bring someone in, I interview them, I keep in mind what this employer wants. The resume could look good. Pass the 6 second test, even got them in for an interview. Get them face to face, nah, you're not gonna fit. Why do I say that? Because I'm thinking if I put you in there, even though you have the necessary skill set, if I send you there knowing that this person just told me this is the type of person we need, he's gonna call me and say, Rodney, why'd you send us that person? I told you what we needed. Yeah, but they got the degree. They got the, you know, they studied this. I told you this was the kind of person we needed. Now I just lost a client. That's money, I got rent. And that's what they're thinking, right? So throughout all of that, I decided, you know what? If someone could just capsulize this, these nuggets, these secrets, these subtle nuances, and then present it in such a fashion that people who need it can use it and be ahead of the game, your closing ratios would increase. I'm not promising that you're going to go out and land the next job you interview for. What I can promise is that you'll feel better about it. You'll feel better about it, right? So this thing called corporate swagger starts with where's my clicker? Starts with, there are five components of it, right? Four of them we'll get into here. The other one we'll dig deeper into in my next workshop. The first one is presidential wardrobe. Presidential wardrobe, I decided that title because I'm tired of hearing about dress for success, dress to impress. I really thought about it. Presidential wardrobe, why those words? If you look at the wardrobe of any president, It is simple, intricate, detailed, and on purpose. I've not seen one president wear cufflinks, flashy ties, you know, a gaudy suit. Not seen it. Regular. However, because they know the stage that they're on and the many millions of eyes that will be on them, they dress accordingly. They make sure that the knot is right, that the lapel is right. They make sure that everything is to a T. Presidential wardrobe, that's one component. Next component, being your own PR firm. In that component, I talk about how to sell your best attributes. Because everybody in here, like it or not, you're in sales. Mr. Yate told you that this morning. You're in sales. You're selling you. So you got to know how to sell you, right? And we're going to have some fun with those first two components because the approach I like to take is I extract principle because principles are transferable. The same principle that created McDonald's is the same principle that created Walmart. Principles are transferable. So if I can extract a principle from over here, transfer it here, and use it, then I become a master at it, right? So the third one is you're finding your inner CEO. Everyone in here is a CEO. I'm not talking about CEO potential. I'm not talking about CEO of your current job. You are a CEO of what you do. You're in charge of it. The thing is, you may or may not act like it on a day-to-day basis. So what I'm going to do is share with you characteristics of successful CEOs, extract it, show you how you may already do some of those things. And when you see you already do what a CEO does, all you then have to do is just do it on a repetitive basis. As you do it on a repetitive basis, it becomes second nature. Now, when it's second nature, it's a part of your fabric. When you go outside these doors, people see you as such because you're acting as such. All right? The next one is getting to the dotted line. Now, again, at some point in your career, whatever it is, you're going to have to negotiate some. You're going to have to close someone on something. Many of you probably already have. If you got a significant other or a girlfriend or boyfriend, congratulations, you closed them, right? I know I closed my wife. Whew. Work, right? And then the last component is backstage pass, but that's what we're going to get into in my next workshop. So let's start off. First of all, presidential wardrobe. Before digging into the obvious, I'm going to touch on the psychological. You got to know the why behind. When I was little, I used to ask the question, why? My mom would slap me. Psh, don't ask me why. Right? I'm serious. When I got older, I decided I'm asking why about everything because I won't get slapped. Right? So I'm going to give you the why behind. Then I'm going to touch on the obvious. So the first thing, presidential wardrobe, you think, okay, dress, how you look. But it's more than that. It's about first impressions. Question, and you all can talk to me. This is interactive. About how long does it take to make a first impression? 10 to 15. Who else we got? I'm doing like an auction. 10 to 15. 10 to 15. Who else we got? 5 seconds. 2.4 seconds. Now, here's why. As humans, with a primal instinct, if you go back to hunter-gatherer days, 2.4 seconds is all a person had if they saw a rustling in the distance to either make a decision, fight or flight, is this friend or foe? You make the wrong decision, you get eaten up. That instinct is still in us. I'll prove it. Okay, talk to the ladies. Ladies, how many times has a guy approached you and you knew in 2.4 seconds, what, see, thank you. Thank you. It happens. 2.4 seconds. So if it's that way in the dating realm, in the personal realm, let's extract the principle. And let's transmute it over into the professional realm. If I know I have 2.4 seconds to make an impression on you, I need to make sure that I'm making the best impression possible, right? And then friend or foe. In that 2.4 seconds, something else is going on. They're determining, are you friend or foe? Not only that, but what's your status? What can you do for me? Can I get something from you? All of that's going on. I've read studies upon studies that hiring executives have made their decision by the handshake. So if you get to go to an interview and you don't get picked, it was just window shopping. They were just filling time. 2.4 seconds, right? So in that 2.4 seconds, what else is going on? Let me see. I got notes. I can tell you. You want to make sure that in that 2.4 seconds, everything is working towards your advantage. So now we get to dress, right? But let's parallel it. Let's look at dating, right? First impressions in dating are serious. They're important because it determines whether or not you're going to achieve your goal, whatever your goal is, getting a number, date, opportunity to talk, coffee, whatever the case may be. So I decided to go on this men's website, Ask Men, and look for, okay, how does it work in the dating world? And let's see if we can parallel it to the business world. I think we can, right? Number 10 says focus on her. Talks about eye contact. Don't focus on things going on around her. Give her all your attention. Make her feel like she's the only one in the room. Okay, in the business realm, eye contact. If I'm sitting in a meeting with an executive, he needs to have my full attention. Not the phone that just went off in my pocket, not what's going on around him, not the rustling behind him in the outside the window. He needs to have my full attention. However, there's something else. It says not too much eye contact because you'll creep her out. Same thing in the business world. Don't stare me down until I bleed. Yeah, see how she just turned? don't stare me down until I bleed, right? So can we say that there's a parallel? Right, now here's the thing. If you can do it there, you already have what it takes to make a first impression in the business world. You just need to flip that switch. Let's keep going. Speak like a normal person. Says, you know, in dating, you know, don't use words that you don't know what they mean. You know, the word of the day that you got on your phone, don't do that, right? Same thing in the business world. Don't go into a meeting trying to expand your vocabulary on the fly. Because here's what's going to happen. They're going to let you. And you're not going to find out that you used that word incorrectly for a couple of months when you're watching TV and you say, oh, dang, that's what that word means. By then, it's done. You already made a bad impression, right? Don't oversell yourself, right? How many times, male and female, we get someone to approach us and they did, you know I'm the man. You know I'm the man, right? Or you, nobody like me, you know? And you find out now you oversold. The same thing in a professional realm. You underpromise, overdeliver. Underpromise, overdeliver. That way you set expectations at a level that you know you can exceed, which then makes you stand out in their eyes. If it works in dating, it works in business. Use humor. I know this one works. I couldn't have got my wife without humor. Because when we go back to high school, and she claims that she liked me back then because I made her laugh. Now, I know that's true because in high school, I was not cute. It's not cute at all. So that's all I could do is make you laugh. To this day, I still make her laugh. My wife, she's a winner, you know? So if it works there, same thing. I'm making you all laugh. I'm engaging with you all through laughter. You can use that same tool in a business setting. Now, no one's saying to go in there and act like you're Jerry Seinfeld. But you need to make sure that you have some point in your interaction where you can create a chuckle, something. Because laughter is medicine. It breaks down walls. It makes it easy for us to interact, right? Smile. Smile is kind of like the stare. You want to smile because a smile says, you're welcome here. A smile says, you can approach me. When I first started out, when I left school, the first guys I worked with, they called me Debo. Not because of my size, but because I always walked around looking what they said was mean. Right? And I'm like, no, I'm not. You know, the sun's in my eyes. Or it's just how I look. Until I started hearing that more and more often. Are you all right? Are you okay? Everything okay? I was like, maybe I do look mean. So then I made myself do it. So I'm like, I'm not going to walk around smiling all day. I'll just lighten up the eyebrows. Right? Just lighten up the eyebrows. Because this can be imposing. Right? So I just lighten up the eyebrows. And then when someone approaches me, how you doing? How you doing? How you doing is my phrase. If I said hello to you today, I'd probably say, how you doing? Because that makes me show a little teeth. Just walking around showing teeth, you know, it feels kind of weird, right? Again, I'm giving you practical. So in business, it's the same thing. When you're sitting opposite of someone who can make decisions, you want to make sure that they feel like they can be a part of what you're offering. Because you're selling. You're selling you. So don't sell you with a frown. You're talking about you. Yeah, I used to, I graduated and then, I mean, I guess I'm good. What? Bye, you know? So smile. Be in the right frame of mind. When you approach someone, you have your mindset on, I'm going to get her number. Nothing else matters because you focused. I'm getting her number. Fellas, going to get her number. Whether you get it or not, you were in the right frame of mind. Same thing in business. No one cares that your dog died, that you were sick yesterday, that, you know, you were in traffic this morning. Atlanta traffic, I thought Houston traffic was bad. Atlanta traffic, y'all on another level. But no one cares. No one cares, right? So make sure that you're in the right frame of mind. It works in both realms. Start a conversation. In a dating room, they talk about pickup lines. Don't be corny, right? I think you all are going to a job fair in a couple weeks or next week, something like that. That's the perfect opportunity, but don't have a pickup line. I was thinking about it. What would I do if I were going in a job fair, knowing that everybody in there is out there for the same thing? How would I differentiate myself? I'm telling you, and I'd have fun doing it. Whoever I wanted to approach, I'd walk up to them. So tell me, what's the worst thing you've heard today? Because they've heard some. They want to be there. I'm talking as a recruiter. Most of the time, they don't want to be there. Right? That's something they were told to do. They have to do as part of their job assignment. But they're on their feet. They're saying the same thing over and over. They want something to break up the monotony. Come in with a conversation that does that. Have you been wild today yet? I mean, has anybody knocked your socks off? I mean, or are they all just giving you resumes and shaking your hand? Yeah, that's what they're doing. Okay, great. Have a seat. What? Yeah, he was talking about it earlier, Mark Yates. You have to do something against the norm. Against the norm. It works in dating like it works here, right? Sit up straight. Posture. I mean, I was reading a book. I'm going to mention a few resources, and I'm doing that so that if you want to jot them down, you can get them yourself. I was reading a book called The Charisma Myth by Olivia Fox Cobain, and she talks about the posture. You want to have the posture of a James Bond. If you ever remember watching a James Bond movie, when James Bond is sitting, right? I wish I had my chair up here. When James Bond is sitting, he has this posture about him that is just, you can't break it. He crosses his legs, and he looks you in the eye, and he has this sense of, you know, whatever you're saying, it don't matter, because I'm running this. So get finished saying what you got to say so that I can tell you what's really going to go down, right? That's his posture. But with a slumped over, you know, posture, you know, you just kind of just flailing at the limbs and things like that, it doesn't work. I mean, would you date this guy? I mean, seriously. Like, ooh, that's the one right there. No, it's not. That's the one to leave, right? Know when to end the conversation. You can talk yourself out of a date. You can talk yourself out of a job. You can talk yourself out of a relationship. You can talk yourself out of a salary. You have to know when you're on a high note and get gone. Leave them wanting more. To when you leave the room, they want to call you back. Now, as I'm mentioning all of this is in practice and it's in, you know, repetition. These are things that I learned trial and error, but I'm telling you they work, right? And then the next one, have a wingman. This one I like because when I read this one, I was like, I don't want a third wheel there, you know, while I'm trying to say hey to a lady. You know, what's that? But he didn't mention that. He said in dating, have a wingman, like if you're a guy, have another female with you because it shows that female that you're going after, that females trust you. I'm like, is that right? So, but here's the thing. I was like, how can I parallel that? Okay, so if I'm at a job fair or I'm talking to someone, my wingman can be other professional suitors, other people who are desiring my services, me. They want me. That's my wingman because now if they see that other people in their industry want me, now that makes me more attractive as a potential employer and potential employee. You see how it works? So now that we've handled the psychological of it, I want to go to the actual dress. I read a lot of Forbes and Entrepreneur Magazine, and in the Forbes magazine, they do this thing called Forbes Makeover. They take a CEO, a prominent business figure, and they do a makeover. They show what he was wearing, what he actually was wearing one day, and then what he should be wearing. Joseph Abboud and Carly Kushine, these are prominent people in the fashion industry. So it's safe to say they know what they're talking about, right? You know who that is, right? Please? Yes? Yes? Okay, Tim Cook from Apple. CEO of Tim Cook from Apple. So let's nitpick him right now. First of all, we know he's doing well. But let's nitpick him. What do you see? Tell me what you see. Jeans, gym shoes. Okay, trying to literally walk in his footsteps, all right? Now, so what those two designers did was that. You can still be casual and still command an executive presence, right? The slim lines in the suit, the shirt that's fitted, you can tell it's fitted because it's not dipping over the belt. I'm gonna go ahead and let one button go on the collar, not gonna wear the tie because I wanna present a casual attire. That's the difference though. Nikes, Phil Knight, CEO of Nike, same thing, right? I mean, that looks like party guy. I mean, yeah. Now, I will say that the jacket and jeans, if you watch, you know, Men's Warehouse commercials, that's becoming a new suit. Say, okay, no problem. But look at the difference. Slimline jeans, not, what do you call those? Not those. Not those. Just without all of the wrinkles, without all the breaks. Dress shoes, and then the shirt with the sweater. Again, casual, he'd still be cool, but let's dress it up a little bit, right? And then this is the CEO of Groupon. Again, want a casual look, but let's dress it up. So my point is, in all of that, is there some do's and don'ts. Some obvious do's and don'ts, right? Let me tell you a story. This young lady reminds me of a true story. As a recruiter, we had a place in our office, like this would be considered the bullpen. This would be where all the recruiters are banging the phones, resumes. I mean, it's just going nonstop. Out here, it's calm and peace and serene in the lobby, right? This is where the recruits and candidates come in. So I had my reception. I called in a young lady. She had all the credentials on the resume. Passed 6-second test. I'm thinking, yes, about to place her. You know, time to get paid, right? My receptionist calls, Rodney, your 2 o'clock appointment is here. Great. Now, because I know that she hasn't seen me, and most recruits do this, I take advantage of that. And we would do what's called a lobby walk-by, right? 2 o'clock appointment's here. Great. I'd go out into the lobby knowing that she hadn't seen me. She's only heard my voice. And I just peruse the lobby. Oh, forgot something. Go back in. True story. I pick up the phone, call my receptionist. Tell me it's not the young lady in the fishnet pantyhose. True story. That I got to do the interview because she's here. Done. I mean, done. So there's some obvious do's and don'ts, right? I tell people, leave weekend wear for the weekend. Don't come to work dressed like you're going to the club. It's not a good look, right? Just go ahead and make it business. Don't wear a lot of makeup. It's distracting, right? Skirt, knee length, shoes, medium to high heels. Not those. And y'all know I'm true. It's out there, right? A lot of you know different, but as a recruiter, I saw that some people actually don't. These are grown people that actually don't, right? Because the bottom line is you're being judged. Everybody's being judged. We don't like it. We can call it, you know, Mr. Yate touched on it this morning, discrimination of all kinds. And it's happening. But we do it too. In 2.4 seconds, we're judging. So if they're going to hire us and give us tens of thousands of dollars per year, they should probably be able to. But here's what they're judging on. So give you a little bit of insight. They're judging your grooming, right? But here's the thing. I want to read something to you. Women are judged more harshly, while 83% of senior executives said unkept attire, including wrinkled or too tight clothing and visible lingerie, detracts from a woman's executive presence. A slightly smaller percentage, 76%, said that it undermines a man's. Posture. We were looking on that dating site, and they were talking about posture, right? Why am I looking at Forbes, and they're talking about we get judged on posture? Because it's real. Right? Physical attractiveness. Now, they're not talking about, you know, if you're pretty or not. Just basically, are you well-groomed? Are you presenting a nice-looking person? Right? The other thing they mention is height. Men are expected to be taller, and so they get graded a lot harder if they're not. Women, you know, kind of get a pass on that one. Right? But we're all being judged. Expensive clothing. Some people think it's nice to come in with, you know, the logo of their Lacoste shirt in the interview. They're judging you on that. Don't do it, right? And then the last thing is youthful appearance. Now, in this one, this is where you have to understand that we all come from different backgrounds, different times. We're of different age. We have different generations represented, even here in this room. But my goal is not to berate you with all of the obstacles against you, but to let you know that if this is the rule book they're playing by, now you know. And if you know the rules, you can alter your approach. Because if we sit down and play a game, you don't tell me the rules, I'm going to lose all day long. But as soon as I know the rules, it's game over and we haven't even started yet. So these are the rules that they're playing by. So now we move to the next part. Being your own PR firm, you got to advertise yourself. I want to read you an excerpt from the book Think and Grow Rich. Do you all... How many people have read this book? Absolutely. For those of you who haven't, please go get it. And I'm saying please because someone introduced this book to me in 1998, and I said probably what you all, most of you all said, yeah, okay, I'll get it. And it resurfaced 14 years later and made a difference in my approach to everything. But I want to read to you an excerpt from it where the author uses a term called transmute. Now, again, we're a room full of adults, so I believe I can go here. But he uses a term called transmute in relation to sexual energy. And you can equate sexual energy to intimacy, love, wanting to be in a relationship, whatever it is. But he says transmuting is just the transferring of energy from one place to another. So he's essentially saying that if you do that, if you can transmute the sexual energy that is innate in all of us, it will elevate you to genius. This is what he's saying. He's saying because of ignorance on the subject, this state of mind is generally associated with the physical. Because of improper influences to which most people have been subjected in acquiring knowledge of sex, things essentially physical have highly biased the mind. The emotion of sex can provide three potentialities. Permeation of humankind, duh. Maintenance of health, that's cool. Transmutation of mediocrity into genius from one place to another, right? He goes on to say, when driven by this desire, people develop keenness of imagination, courage, willpower, persistence, and creative ability unknown to them at any other time. Now let's pause. When you set your sights on, I'm going to get her number, your creative juices start flowing. How am I going to do this? I got to be different because the last dude I saw, he got shot down. Okay, so I got to do this. You're tapping into some creative stuff. So it's saying if you can transmute that, this is what the author is saying. If you can move that over into the business realm, it will elevate you to genius, right? Last thing, he did a study. He said there was a study done on 30,000 salespeople. 30,000 salespeople, and this study was made, that they were highly sexed people and the most efficient sales reps. The explanation is that the factor of personality known as personal magnetism. You ever said anybody had that? He said, it's got so much magnetism. Yeah, he's transmuting. She's transmuting. They didn't figure it out. Personal magnetism is nothing more or less than sex energy. Highly sexed people always have a plentiful supply of magnetism. Through cultivation and understanding, this vital force may be drawn upon and used to great advantage in relationships between people. The energy may be communicated through handshake, tone of voice, posture. There it goes again. Vibrations of thought, body adornment. I didn't say it. Napoleon Hill said it. He's a lot smarter than me. So my point in that is that when you're trying to sell your best attributes, there's a switch that you need to turn on. Hear me clearly. I'm not saying look at everyone in a sexual way. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that there's an energy that triggers in you, that if you can learn how to transmute it into the business realm, you'll get the results you want. Now, I will say it works because I know in sales, you got to close. And there's been times when I've been playful in a verbal way with the tone of my voice. Handshake was firm to let them know I do mean business, so don't come past this line. But there was that energy because without a degree and without everything else that my counterparts had, I had to find something. I just didn't know what it was called. When I read that book, I said, that's what I got. So that there's truth in that. So thing is, you're a commercial. Mr. Yate touched on it today. You're a commercial and you have a limited amount of time, 30 seconds, right? There's a study that I read, another Forbes study, and I'll show it here later, where it says executives have made their decision between that 2.5 to 30 minute time period, and they've judged you on three things: professionalism, leadership, and courage. In 30 seconds, handshake, looking you in the eye, yeah, next. It's just a donk. So if you got that amount of time, you need to make sure that you can sell yourself in 30 seconds. So I'm gonna give you some nuggets on how to do that. Number one, know exactly where you wanna go. When someone asks you, you know, your elevator pitch and things like that, know exactly where you want to go. You need to make sure you tell them who you are, what you do, and what your goal is. Number two, bullet point it. Look at your resume. Find four things that stand out tremendously, that you excel at tremendously. Bullet point them and make sure to limit any irrelevant jargon, any irrelevant topics. You just want to focus in on those things. Then you want to tell them a story. People use stories as a way of engaging, right? When I'm asked, you know, so tell me about yourself, I always make the joke. So see, I'm hitting two birds in one stone. I'm gonna make you laugh, and I'm about to tell a story. I say, well, it started when I was a wee little boy. And they say, ha, 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 boom, made them laugh. Okay, check that off. Now I'm about to finish telling my story. I'm just going to fast forward a little bit, right? Just like the story I came out and told you all. So you want to tell a story. Story makes people remember you. Then eliminate jargon that doesn't, I already mentioned that. Eliminate jargon that doesn't matter. Make sure that it invites conversation. Make sure that whatever you're telling them, like a commercial. You see a commercial for a product or service that you want. Hey, sweetie, we need that, don't we? No, yeah, we do. You know, you're trying to convince. So you want to make sure that it tells a story and invites conversation. And then you want to record yourself on video. There's absolutely no reason why you can't do this now, because everybody has a phone and you take selfies of yourself all the time. Put it to use and record yourself giving your speech, giving your pitch, right? And then you want to practice it. Because again, this is just like a game. Teams have practice so that when they go out on the court, nothing is a surprise to them. Why don't we practice for our interviews? Why don't we practice telling people, this is who I am, this is what I do, this is where I plan on going? Why don't we spend more time practicing? That sounds like Allen Iverson. Practice? Yeah, practice. You got to spend more time practicing, right? Now, the next thing that I want to talk about is finding your inner CEO. Again, let's go to the psychology of it. The psychology of it says that I'm not a CEO, but if I find out what CEOs do, maybe I can emulate them. And that's true. Because CEOs do a lot of the stuff that everyone in here does on a day-to-day basis. They just do it for a purpose, where we happen to do it, right? For instance, question, show of hands. Who in here has vision? Yeah, CEOs. Right? See, when a CEO has vision, professionally, it's the ability to articulate that vision to a group of people so that they can run with it, so that they become captivated by that vision. Okay, so how do I parallel that in my personal life? How can I, you know, practice that on a day-to-day basis? If you have anybody in your house, children, husband, wife, whatever the case, you work with people, you're a part of a group, a club, whatever, you need to have a vision. And the way you practice it is, you let them know what your vision is. And do it to the point to where you're trying to captivate them to have them become part of your vision, whatever it is. Maybe it's in a networking group, but you got to have vision. So if CEOs have vision, and you all say you have vision, you can say that you share that. Now, these are the top five characteristics of successful CEOs. You're now in that same circle. But they know they do it on purpose. The next thing they do. They macro-manage, they don't micromanage. They keep their eyes on the big picture. They don't get bogged down with minute day-to-day transactions, but they make sure that on the grand scheme of things, everything is flowing according to plan. Again, something that you can do at home. What's the vision for your home? What's the vision for your family? What's the vision for you? Macro-manage it. Make sure that it's the main picture. Don't let the small things get in the way. Don't get distracted. Because that's a quality that CEOs have. So how many of you in here can manage people? You manage people at home, you manage people, period. You can tell somebody what to do. Yeah. Now, if you got vision and you can manage people, that means that you can take that vision and keep your eye on the bigger purpose and manage towards the bigger good. Agreed? Agreed? Cool. Next thing they do, they leverage industry trends. What you all are doing right now, CEOs do or have done. They find out what's the latest trend, what's the latest product, what's the latest technology, what class do I need to take, are there any certifications I'm lacking, what knowledge can I get a hold of to make our bottom line explode exponentially, what can I do to better the company? CEO, you, what can I do to better me? It goes back to what Mr. Yate was saying, you're Me Inc. You're your own company. So doing what you're doing now, bravo. Because you're doing what CEOs do. They invest in themselves. They invest the time, the energy, and the effort to make sure that they're up on trends, that they're leveraging trends in the industry. Then they develop a foundation of strength. They surround themselves with people that hold them accountable. I have a colleague that does a thing called a CEO roundtable on a quarterly basis. CEOs from different industries get together and they brush up on their training, they network with one another. But think about that, a room full of nothing but CEOs, you know, that's an exclusive club. Why can't you have it? B&I, Toastmasters, groups and organizations around campus, create your own group, mothers in this community, doesn't matter. But there needs to be a level of accountability that you can be held to, right? Because when you do that, again, now you're remaining in that CEO circle. And then the last thing is, customers are their core. They understand where they make their money. They understand who's buying their product, who's buying their service. Customers are their core. We say, okay, well, I don't have customers, I don't have a business. Yes, you do, your family. They're buying what you're selling. If it's a way of life, this is how this house is gonna function. This is the rules we're gonna live by. You know, these are the values that we're gonna have. That's what you're selling them. You're selling them that's right, that's what's gonna work. So you need to make sure that you take them into respect in that decision making. How to see it from their eyes. Empathy, sympathy, having both, right? So once you do that, you can say, okay, now I'm doing what CEOs do. Because those are the top five characteristics of a CEO. So once you're in that circle, then you just need to make sure that you, on a day-to-day basis, you continue to magnify those five traits. Be mindful of them. Make them points where you don't forget. Am I keeping the customer's core? Is my vision in front of me? Am I getting bogged down with the small things? Right? Once you're mindful of that on a day-to-day basis, you begin to act like a CEO acts, regardless of what you have or don't have. You begin to act like it. And then once you start acting like it, people will take you as such. You'll be at your job and someone will come up to you and ask you, are you the manager? Because you look like it. You look like the answer is supposed to be yes. You walk into a store, you know, be it a car manufacturer, whatever the case may be, and they straighten up around you. You just came from the house. They don't know that. Because now you're giving that vibe off, right? These are things that worked for me, and I know they'll work for you because it's not rocket science. These are the things that with the degree, with the content knowledge that you're getting here at this college, you'd be able to put these process skills with it, and then it's game over and you haven't even started yet. Then you can sit next to that, you know, Georgia grad, that Georgia State grad, and wait for your name to get called for that interview knowing that it don't even matter. I don't know why y'all here. Sure hate it for you. It doesn't matter because you have the mindset that says, I act like a CEO. I know how to make a good first impression. I know how to sell my best attributes. I understand the psychology behind little things, right? I have some magnetism that I know how to put to work. It's done, right? So that's how you can find your inner CEO. Last, getting to the dotted line. Again, I say, at some point in your career, you're gonna have to get to a point to where you're gonna have to close business, close a contract, negotiate something. This is not a portion where, you know, I'm gonna give you something new under the sun. I'm gonna share with you five different types of closes and how to use them. You can play with them on people at home, and that's how I did. I got real good at doing it with friends of mine. I was like, yeah, I closed them. You know, until I can go out into the business world and do the same thing. So the first type of close I'm gonna share with you is called an assumptive close. This is where you ask a question and